I would like to welcome muna Mr. Chair Ado Paglinawan, who is our resource person right now. He just appeared and he's there right now. Mr. Chair, I give you the floor to welcome Mr. Ado Paglinawan.
Yes, we'd like to recognize and welcome Mr. Ado Paglinawan. Please come forward and be recognized as now a participant in our Shadow Congress of the 1899 Constitution.
Point of information, welcome. Mr. Speaker. Yes. Mr. Ado Paglinawan is representing the district of Quezon that include Tiaong, because he is a native of that place. He is now officially joining us in this Congress as a member of that district representative. So I give you the floor back, Mr. Speaker.
Okay, excellent. So welcome, Mr. Ado Paglinawan. Please step forward, so to speak.
Yeah, magandang gabi, magandang umaga sa inyong lahat. Depende kung nasaan kayo. Medyo akala ko madali itong assignment sa akin ni Gil Ramos, pero kinailangang bigyan ng kaunting seryosong pansin dahil napipinto rito ang maraming particular na sa hinaharap ng mga kabataan ngayon na tumitingin sa kanilang kinabukasan, ay maaaring ito na ang pagkakataon. Ito na ang pagkakataon para magkaroon tayo ng pagbaklas sa 500 taon na sumpa ng kolonyalismo sa ating bansa. Nagsimula ito nung tayo pangalanan. Hindi ko maintindihan kung base sa pangalan ng hari ng Espanyang si Felipe o di kaya ay sa kanyang sakit na syphilis. So I would like to start with that banner para maintindihan natin kung ano nangyari mula nung itanim ni Magallanes ang kurus ng sumpa sa puluhan ng mga Maharlika. Anyway, dito sa pagbubukas ay masasabi ko na sa 2 nobela ni Rizal, ginawa niyang purpose ay bigyan tayo ng 2 advice that might serve as warnings not only to the Spaniards but also to the Filipinos of during that time. Doon sa una, he served notice on the Spaniards that if the Spanish government, in order to please the friar, remain deaf to the demands of the Filipino people, the latter would have recourse in desperation to violent means and seek independence relief for its sorrows. By the way, itong aking sinasaad ngayon ay base kay Apolinario Mabini sa kanyang Memorias de la Revolucion Filipina. At marami rito ay inedit ko lamang. Sa pangalawang warning ay para sa mga Pilipino na kung if they should take up their country's cause motivated by personal hatred and ambition, they would far from helping it only make it suffer all the more. At ito nakikita natin dahil tayo galing sa 30 taon ng Aquino the Mother to Aquino the Son, 30 years of vindictiveness, revenge, and hatred. Ang gusto ng ibig sabihin dito ni Rizal ay only those actions would benefit the Filipinos which were dictated by true patriotism, which not only demands the sacrifice to the common good of personal revenge and ambition, but also requires the lack of self-interest abnegation and gratitude of Elias, symbolizing the love and devotion of Jose Rizal. It is undeniable that in the Philippines, the desire for improvement was great and widespread. It is not possible to explain otherwise the mistrust and hatred that the Filipinos, from the most ignorant to the most cultured, were beginning to feel through the friars in the meantime that they realized that the latter tenaciously opposed all reform. Hindi talaga pagbibigyan ang mga Pilipino. Time was when the friars were wont to defend, no, the natives against the rapacity of the encomenderos. For in those days, the friars, trapped in their own selfishness and the Catholic religion not deeply rooted, they had great need of confidence and love for their parishioners, whose trust and candor once exploited, they then became rich and arrogant. Ito mga priory na ito. How was it that they forgot those sweet and gentle accents that had worked such miracles from their faith? It was because whoever acts in bad faith corrupts himself, and corrupt hearkens not to the voice of reason, but to that of passion. The love and respect that everyone professed for Rizal, Marcelo del Pilar, and all other patriots who collaborated with them in the great work of the national regeneration manifested clearly and openly the political aspiration of the Filipinos. That La Solidaridad had faithfully interpreted those aspirations was likewise shown by the fact that its expenses were met by Filipinos residing in the islands, who were thus risking their personal safety and interests. From the start of the periodical's publication, a number of Manila residents, calling themselves propagandists, distributed the issues which were smuggled into the city and collected subscriptions and contributions given by patriots in Manila and neighboring provinces. Lately ko lang nalaman that much of this pala was supported by the underground economy of Binondo. As such, they had occasion to visit the capital. Well-to-do and educated persons from distant provinces were also wont to give their help. If the rich men of Manila contributed very little, it was because they mistrusted the person in charge of the funds and feared for their own interests. When he realized that this disorderly and ill-coordinated effort yielded little, walang sustainability and funding, Rizal thought of organizing a society called Liga Pilipina, which was inaugurated a few days before his exile to the Pitan in Mindanao. The statute of this association was limited to the establishment by the very votes of its members of people's councils in the towns, a provincial council in every province, a supreme council for the whole archipelago, but did not define the objectives of the association. According to Mambini, he did not know if these objectives were defined in the inaugural meeting over which Rizal himself personally presided, because he was not present, and because he never had close relations with the illustrious doctor. Hindi po close si Mabini at si Rizal. All Mabini could say was that society was dissolved a few days, itong pong La Liga Pilipino was dissolved a few days after its inauguration because of the banishment of its founder. It was reorganized later on the initiative of Don Domingo Franco, Andres Bonifacio, and others, giving the post of Secretary of the Supreme Council to Mabini. They then fixed the objectives of the society in a short program couched in the following equivalent language. Number one, to contribute to the support of La Solidaridad and the reforms it asks. Number two, to raise funds to meet the expenses not only of the periodical but also of the public meetings organized to support such reforms and of the Spanish parliamentarians who would advocate them. And number three, to have recourse to all peaceful, thus transforming the society into a political party. I assume for possible representation in the Spanish Cortes. To ulitin ko yon. Thus transforming the society into a political party for purposes of representation in the Spanish Cortes. The association, however, did not have better faith this time, for it had to be dissolved after a few months of life. However, it had promising beginnings. The majority of the members of the Supreme Council were persons known for their learning, patriotism, and social status. Thanks to the effort of Andres Bonifacio and others, people's councils were soon organized in Tondo and Troso, while others were being organized in Santa Cruz, Ermita, Malate, Sampaloc, Pantacan, and more. This was our first established history of orderly community organizing. Subsequently, a small monthly contribution was required from every member, the proceeds of which were applied to the expenses of La Solidaridad, which were mostly urgent to be met. The members paid their dues at first, but later stopping on the pretext that they did not agree with the society's objectives because the Spanish government paid no attention, hindi pinansin. Yung periodical, nor in fact would do so to any lawful activity. Deadma, dinedma ng mga Espanyol. Upon investigation, it then transpired that those who commissioned to organize the People's Councils had not required previous affirmation to the society's program as a condition for membership in the society. Medyo nag-ministerial sign-ups lang. Like what most organizations and NGOs do right now in the Philippines. They just pass on a piece of paper with people signing without people understanding what they were signing for. The Supreme Council, which was more of an organizing committee because its members had not been elected by a vote, saw clearly that as soon as the rank and file elected their members according to the bylaws, the program would be changed. The council understood for the first time that the masses, whom the Spaniards believed to be brutish or at best indifferent, were in the vanguard, were political. Realizing that the work of conciliation and compromise was bringing no results, the council declared the dissolution of the society so that disagreements among its members should not lead to its discovery by the authorities. Those who were in favor of keeping up with the fortnightly publication formed one group called Compromisarios, because each one engaged to pay a monthly contribution of 5 pesos to meet its expenses. Andres Bonifacio, for his part, reorganized the society under the name of Katipunan ng Mga Anak ng Bayan, Association of the Sons of the People, already with independence as its objective. And we already know the Katipunan grew very rapidly because the insolent and provocative way in which the priors carried out their campaigns had exasperated the masses. But if the organization, political organizations, had been permitted in the archipelago, and if the middle class, which was the most educated and influential, had been able to move freely, it could have undoubtedly calm the people's anger down and obstructed the growth of the Katipunan, since that class was resolutely in favor of La Liga's program, even after having endured most cruel sufferings, even more after the Pact of Biak na Bato. So this is the first part. Fast forward tayo to the American time. dito nagsimula, saan nagtapos. As Mabini had foreseen, our improvised militia could not withstand the first blow struck by the disciplined American troops. Fast forward tayo sa Americano. Moreover, it must be admitted that the Filipino forces stationed around Manila were not prepared for the attack that night. General Ricarte, in command of the detachments in the south, and General San Miguel, commander of the eastern zone where the attack began, were then in Malolos. Little accustomed to the war, Filipino commanders and officers hardly appreciated the value of military instruction and discipline, so that the placements were not served with anything approaching order and precision. The Filipino general staff had not studied or laid down any plans for offensive or withdrawal movements in case of an outbreak of hostility. Emilio Aguinaldo, who had scant appreciation of the advantages of a unified command and coordinated tactics, had made no provision for the prompt restoration of communications among the various units should sudden retreat interrupt the telegraphic system. He wanted to keep his forces around Manila under his direct orders, commanding them from his residence in Malolos, although he could not devote himself completely to the proper discharge of duties of this command because of his preoccupations as head of government and the conceit of personally deciding many matters which should have been channeled through the departments or cabinet of the central administration. Micromanager Paul C. Emilio Aguinaldo. Only after the outbreak of hostilities, when the telegraph lines had already been cut, did he name Antonio Luna. General Antonio Luna, commander of the forces operating around Manila. But by that time, the various army units had already evacuated their own entrenchments, their old entrenchments, and communications among them had become slow and hazardous. Furthermore, Luna resigned his command shortly afterwards because the war minister had disapproved one of his dispositions. He, however, resumed command of the defense operations north of Manila when the provincial government was compelled to leave Malolos for Isidro in the province of Nueva Ecija. Luna was able to raise fresh forces in Kalumpit, forming a number of companies composed of veteran soldiers from the former native army organized by the Spanish government. And with these troops as a core, he imposed a stern disciplinary system to stop the demoralization of the troops. But many commanders, jealous of their authority, withheld from him the effective cooperation that was necessary. This led to the cashiering by brute force of commanders who did not recognize his authority or the court, marshalling of those who abandoned their posts in the face of the enemy or the disarming of troops that disobeyed his orders. In spite of all this, obstacles, Luna would have succeeded in imposing and maintaining discipline if Aguinaldo had supported him with all the power of his prestige and authority. But the latter was also beginning to grow jealous, seeing Luna slowly gaining ascendancy by his bravery, audacity, and military skill. All those affronted by his actuation were inducing Aguinaldo to believe that Luna was plotting to wrest from him the supreme authority and power. So after the Kalumpit Bridge had fallen to the American forces, due mainly to the scarcity of ammunition, Luna rushed to see Mabini in San Isidro and entreated him to convince Aguinaldo of that time had come to adopt guerrilla warfare. Mabini promised to do so, but while making it clear to him that he may not get anywhere because his advice was hardly heeded in military matters in as much as him not being a military man. but a man of letters. Mabini could not keep his promise because he did not see Aguinaldo until after some time. Besides having relinquished office to his successor, Don Pedro Paterno, in the first days of May 1899, Mabini left for the town of Rosales near Bayambang. That date is important because May 1899, nandyan na po ang Malolos Constitution. A few weeks later, Aguinaldo sent a telegram asking Luna to see him in Kamanatuan for an exchange of views. But when Luna arrived in Kamanatuan, he did not find Aguinaldo at home, but he found his death by treachery plotted by the very same soldier whom he had disarmed and court-martialed for abandonment of their post and disobedience to his orders. Colonel Francisco Roman, who accompanied Luna, died with him. Before his death, Luna had his headquarters in Bayambang and had reconnoitered Banguet to determine if it met the conditions for an efficacious defense in case of a retreat. Because Luna was trying to draw the American forces farther to the north. What is more, he was already beginning to transport there the heavier pieces of ordnance. While Luna was being murdered, Aguinaldo was in Tarlac, taking command of the forces which the deceased had organized, establishing his government in Tarlac, wasting his time on political and literary activity. So much that this negligence, General Otis exploited by landing his infantry in San Fabian while his cavalry wheeled through San Jose and Omingan Pangasinan, taking San Quintin and Tayug, thus cutting all Aguinaldo's lines of retreat and giving the death blow to the revolution, to the armed revolution. Mabini found it hard to believe that Luna was plotting to wrest from the presidency from Aguinaldo because Luna seriously aspired to be prime minister to replace Paterno, who was advocating an autonomy program that he thought was a violation of the fundamental law of the state and a punishable crime. Note that Luna was already functioning here under a constitutional democracy as the Malolos Constitution went into effect January 21, 1899. The general was assassinated less than 5 months after in June 5, 1899. Mabini records the true ambitions of Luna to support Aguinaldo by being the prime minister. Anyway, this is shown by the report in the Independencia inspired by Luna and published a few days before his death, which stated that the Paterno Buen Camino, remember those things, cabinet would be replaced by another in which Luna would be prime minister as well as war minister. Within a few days, Luna received Aguinaldo's telegram calling him to Kabanatuan, and you already know what happened. Luna had certainly allowed himself to stay on occasion that Aguinaldo had a weak character and was unfit to be a leader. But such language was only an explosive outlet for a fiery and ebullient temperament which saw its plans frustrated by lack of necessary support. High blood po kasi si Luna. All of Luna's activities revealed integrity and patriotism combined with a zealous activity that measured up to the situation. Ito po ang account ni Mabini na inuulit ko sa inyo. If Luna was sometimes hasty and even cruel in his decision, it was because the army was in a desperate position due to the demoralization of the troops and the lack of munitions. Only acts of daring and extraordinary energy could prevent its disintegration. The death of Aguinaldo had plainly shown that, the death of Andres Bonifacio later have plainly shown in Emilio Aguinaldo a boundless appetite for power, and Antonio Luna's personal enemies exploited his weakness of Aguinaldo with skillful intrigues in order to deliver Luna's ruin. Can we say, therefore, that if Aguinaldo, instead of having Luna killed, had supported him with all his power, the revolution would have triumphed? Well, we could do a presumption. Mabilis doubts, however, that the Americans would have a higher regard for the courage and military activities of the Filipinos. But had Luna been alive, Mabini was sure that Otis' mortal blow would have been parried, or at least timely prevented, and if Aguinaldo's unfitness for military command would not have been exposed so clearly. Furthermore, to rid of Luna, Aguinaldo had recourse to the very soldiers whom Luna had punished for breaches of discipline. By doing so, Aguinaldo destroyed that leadership within his own army. With Luna, its most firm support fell, the revolution. And the ignominy of the fall bearing wholly on Aguinaldo brought about in turn his own moral death, 1,000 times more bitter than physical. Aguinaldo therefore ruined himself, damned by his own deeds in what were great crimes punished by the divine prophet. Today, as we speak, my mind took to the shores of the past, because 2 days ago, July 1, the People's Republic of China celebrated its 100 years anniversary. Prior to this was the G7 in the United Kingdom, where the United States was playing a catch-up with its European allies to recover waning space that had been attracted to China. But if the West were to catch up, former Liberian Public Works Minister Gude Moore implies that it may have to change its model. He said, in renegotiating our compact with the U.S., a constraint analysis has to be done first, a growth diagnostics that tends to answer the question, what is the binding constraint to economic growth within a country? He was speaking, of course, in behalf of Liberia and the African states. But this might as well be true to us, because we are about in a stage where President Duterte has declared that independence foreign policy, putting us slightly on the side of China, but in the middle with the U.S. on the other side. The U.S., however, has been busy with wars all over the world, hastened since September 11, 2001. Ito po yung Twin Towers, where the war against Al-Qaeda was declared. That in so short a time, the U.S. has been overtaken by China in so many respects. 2001 was 20 years ago. China was at the center of its 100 years of humiliation in the 1930s. 30 years after, in 1960, it was coming out of its revolutionary shell. By 1990s, it was tinkering on democratic socialism, rising out of the Cultural Revolution. Today, after another 30 years, it is already exporting communitarian democracy using the revival of the Old Silk Road onto the Belt and Road Initiative as its economic thrust into a shared future with humanity. As recent as 10 years ago in 2010, Dr. Bao Gang Guo asked, to what extent will democracy expand in Chinese society in the next few decades under the auspices of one party rule and under the system of a corporatist state. Since Dr. Guopo got his PhD in political science from the Brandeis University in Massachusetts, USA, although he got his Bachelor of Arts and Master of Arts from Shenzhou University in China. And he is a professor of political science at the Dalton State College and a research associate at the China Research Center in Atlanta, Georgia, USA. The question was triggered by the seeming dichotomy between authoritarianism and democracy, and how China was challenging itself to melt into an impasse, into a paradigm that would best suit its 1.5 billion people, population. Definitely. If taken too lightly, it will implode. If taken loosely, it will explode. This means that in Confucian terms, that is, in terms of Confucius, China needs to develop a Xiongyong style of governance model that combines a strong state with decentralized democratic politics. It may resist the idea of liberalism, as it will remain a communist state in the predictable future. But it does not and cannot resist the idea of democracy. Kang Xiaoguang, a well-known scholar in China, says Confucianism disagrees with liberalism in that it does not recognize the notion that all men are equal. Instead, Confucianism says that it is inequality that leads to meritocracy that have persisted in Chinese history. And the legitimacy of meritocracy is the rule of benevolence. How do we reconcile this? And later on with the Filipino history. Unlike liberalism, which considers the state to be a necessary evil, di ba, lagi magkabanggaan ang liberalism at saka ang Estado. Ang gobyerno. Confucianism believes that it is the state that is always needed for public welfare. It may attempt developing its model of democracy that will best suit its own needs for efficiency and equity, a model that will also unite its past with the present, a model that will accompany the needs of the strong state and the needs for a larger yet vibrant civil society. And this is what is called as vertical democracy. John Naisbitt claims that a new vertical democracy, which combines the bottom-up democracy with the top-down central command, is emerging in China and is an insightful analysis. Vertical democracy as an alternative to the horizontal democracy of the West may also be called by some as collective democracy, in which traditional collectivism will be combined with individual rights. The notion of vertical democracy is not new. Aristotle's idea of government is a polity, a state in which rich and poor respect each other's rights and best qualified citizens rule with the consent of all, and a form of government that infuses oligarchy with democracy. Oligarchy here is not to be meant originally, but the rule of the rich and powerful, the ruling elite. Mendem idea is an essential value of the paternalistic state. The Communist Party of China has endorsed the Leninist democratic centralism for many years that calls for freedom of discussion, unity in action. The key to developing the democratic component of this doctrine is enabling the ruling party, serving as the core of a new democracy, to balance exercising veto powers while practicing governance over popular wishes, tempering cultural influence on a new Chinese polity.
I know.
Having taken a slice of Philippine history and the dissonance in it, and having taken a sample of what is happened and happening in China, let us look to the future of Philippine politics. Ito pong kubol na ito, this nipahat of ours has taken fancy. Itong usapin natin dito, itong grupo natin, with the Malolos Constitution of 1899, against all forms of basic laws, this constitution stands out as the only truly basic law that has been developed genuinely by Filipinos. Its specificity is definitely a reaction to the denial of civil and human rights by the Spanish rule. It marks champion basic freedoms as an expression of our forebears preferring a democratic way of life. But read through it, the traces of authoritarianism is also evident. A powerful president who is the commander-in-chief of the military. There are checks and balances, and most may be imputed afterwards, as Gil Ramos and I agree, through constitutional amendments as we go. But this positions us to be ready for the ghosts of Rizal, Bonifacio, and Luna, who now haunts us from the accounts of Mabini. So this leads me back to where I started, to the La Liga Pilipina, which I hope ushers in a single party system. But even before that, I wish to say that our tendency to legalism must be tempered by a cultural reorientation of our people back to the Bathalas, where we came from, as we were mga Tagapulo, people of the islands, and this Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Luzbininda. Has become a melting pot of migration from all around us, including the Chinese and the Arab traders. If China eventually succeeded defining itself to the modern man, it was the paradigm shift that Hu Jintao reintroduced from its long history to define the characteristics of China's communism. It had to be done because with the economic power blending with the political power wielded by the Communist Party of China, the temptation to transforming into a second hegemon, given the U.S. activities around the world, was becoming very strong within China and its leadership. Left alone, that would spell a Third World War or a more bitter Cold War at the very least. It was the effort of Hu Jintao, reviving the preeminence of the Mandarin term Hosui onto the centrality of the Chinese consciousness. Translated, this meant promotion of the harmonious society, reconciling a strong central power in coexistence with democratized population base. In internationalizing this principle, Xi Jinping now successfully extends this to promote a harmonious world of a community of shared future for humanity. China's use of its economy as soft power is a deliberate move to stray away from U.S. economy, hegemony, to avoid a confrontation where all sides lose. If China can modernize Confucian and arrive at a win-win solution, we can revive our humble beginnings, nurtured with the ideals of Jose Rizal, the courage of Bonifacio, and the tenacity of Luna, with Mabini as our recording secretary. Together with the political infrastructure of the Malolos Constitution, to arrive at our own version of a vertical democracy. This will give direction to Kami Lutayan's trinity of political liberation, economic emancipation, and social concord. And those who wish to truncate our present governance madness with a revolutionary government, but with little or no bloodshed. Maraming salamat po. Thank you and good day. I now open myself to questions.